Hello, and welcome to broadcast number 12 for the Philothea Press bestseller, Work of Human Hands, a Theological Critique of the Mass of Paul VI, by the Reverend Anthony Cekada. To order Work of Human Hands and to read excerpts, visit www.sggresources.org. Chapter 12, Part 1. The Roman Canon, Liturgical Decadence. All the historic liturgies in both the East and the West place the words that our Lord used to institute the Eucharist, "This is my body, and this is my blood," in the context of a longer prayer, which is called by a variety of names. In the Old Mass, the prayer is called the Canon, and consists of one invariable text. In the New Mass, it's called the Eucharistic Prayer, and there are at least 17 different texts for it. This broadcast will deal primarily with the Old Canon. Our next installment will deal with the prayers that replaced it. The meaning of the term canon. The term canon is the Greek word for a norm or a rule. It also has overtones of a fixed measure or a yardstick. Pope Benedict XIV said that the Church used the term canon to signify that the prayer is, quote, the firm rule according to which the sacrifice of the New Testament must be celebrated. This implies something virtually unchangeable. Although we cannot give an exact date for its origin, the Roman canon in the traditional Mass is extremely ancient. Some authors say it originates in apostolic tradition. Others trace its core to the 2nd and 3rd centuries. One of the things we've noticed is that the Reformers loved to relabel ideas connected with the sacred liturgy, usually with longer phrases. Ushers became ministers of hospitality. I was not just an organist, I was a minister of music. Because the Reformers sought to change or replace the Roman canon, the fixed rule, retaining the old label would have created a fundamental contradiction in terms. The new term the revisers decided on was Eucharistic prayer, which they extended to include the preface and the Sanctus as well. The preface. The preface, in both the old rite and the new, is a prayer of thanksgiving, which varies according to the feast or liturgical season. Typically, it contains three elements. Homage to God the Father, enumeration of the reasons for thanksgiving, and an evocation of the angels. In the Church's early centuries, there is a tendency to provide a proper preface for every Mass formulary. The sacramentary attributed to Pope St. Gelasius, for instance, contained 54 prefaces, the Leonine sacramentary, 267. Sometimes the authors got a little too specific about what they were asking for. One ancient preface was a long and violent attack on monks. Alas, it was too early for one against the Jesuits. A lot of traditionalists these days might feel they could put a preface like that to really good use. In the Roman Rite, the number was eventually reduced. The traditional missal contained only 15 prefaces. Adding a few more wouldn't have been a bad idea, but the creators of the new Mass came up with another dizzying array of options. The 1970 edition of the missal contains 81 prefaces. Three more were added in 1975. But what about their content? In his apostolic constitution promulgating the new missal, Paul VI said that the great number of prefaces are, quote, drawn from the early tradition of the Roman Church, or recently composed. Once again, we have the customary appeal to antiquity, oh, those ancient Christians. And as usual, we discover it is antiquity with a modern twist. In their 600-page work documenting the sources for the new prefaces, Fathers Anthony Ward and Cuthbert Johnson
state that the revisers adopted a conscious policy of forming new texts out of, quote, a mosaic of phrases from the liturgical tradition.
Why not just use those much vaunted ancient texts? The answer from Concilium's experts will sound depressingly familiar.
The principle followed for choosing texts, said Father Antoine Dumas, was pastoral needs. Thus, the texts selected had to be ones that could be adapted to the modern mentality. Therefore, he said, only a few texts were retained integrally. Otherwise, quote, the better texts, reproduced in their original form, would have been unbearable, if not defective.
So, in the new prefaces, we get the early tradition of the Roman Church, but only where early tradition is not unbearable or defective.
The movement to change the canon. The modernist wing of the liturgical movement had already targeted the Roman canon in the late 1940s. Jungmann proposed shortening the canon and revising the list of saints it contained.
Their motives for changing the canon were the usual ones at work elsewhere in the Reform, ecumenism and modernism. The text of the canon contained ideas that the Protestant heretics objected to, so it presented an obstacle to ecumenism. For modernists, the Roman canon was objectionable because it was linked to the Tridentine theology of the Mass and didn't fit into their academic theories of how such a prayer should be structured.
Bugnini's assistant, Father Carlo Braga, said, quote, all texts, even the most venerable, must be submitted to an examination of textual criticism and of psychological consideration, by which they would be able more fittingly to respond to the requirement of our times. The reviser's attitude is best summed up in the words of Bugnini. The Roman canon, he said, represented a deplorable impoverishment, resulting from centuries of liturgical decadence. Vatican II did not explicitly authorize a change in the canon. Instead, the general principles on liturgical reform that had been written into the Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy were used to justify the change. So in 1966, an influential book appeared, The Canon of the Mass and Liturgical Reform, to lay out all the arguments. Its author, the Benedictine liturgist Cipriano Vagagini, attacked the canon as an agglomeration of features with no apparent unity, lacking a logical connection of ideas, unsatisfactory, with its intercessory prayers full of disorder, deficiencies.
After reading Vagagini, you wonder how the Church survived with such a prayer for over 1,500 years. His criticisms, as we will see, eventually led Paul VI to allow the introduction of alternative texts for the Roman canon. But before we examine these texts, we will first examine two other changes to the canon that were introduced in 1967.
A sacred stillness reigns no more. As you would expect, in the new Mass, the Eucharistic prayers are recited or chanted aloud. At the traditional Mass, the priest recites the Roman canon in what the rubrics call the secret voice. He pronounces the words in such a way that he can hear himself, but not be heard by others nearby.
Obviously, there's a shift of symbolism here. It is worth looking at this more closely because it pertains to the most important prayer in each of the two rites.
Symbolism and origins. Father Nicholas Geer gives the chief reasons for reciting the canon in silence. First, the consecration and sacrificial act are exclusively priestly functions. Second, silence harmonizes with the essence of the mystery. The material elements are changed without the senses perceiving it. Third, silence expresses awe. Fourth, it withdraws the sacred words from ordinary discourse. Fifth, it mystically represents Christ praying in silence during his agony. Despite extensive investigations by liturgical scholars, one cannot say for certain when or where the silent recitation of the canon originated. However, we do know from two texts, one anonymous and another from Almarius of Metz, that the silent recitation of the Roman canon was fully entrenched in the West by the 9th century at least. It was introduced most probably due to a spirit of awe in the presence of the sacred mystery. Protestant objections. In modern times, the move to alter the venerable practice of the silent canon originated with the 16th century Protestants. For them, the principal purpose of worship was to stir up faith by imparting the word to men. Though grim fellows like these were unlikely to hand out balloons to make the point, theirs was the worship as classroom approach. Men can hardly be instructed by a prayer recited silently. Silent recitation also implies that a mere work can please God, and moreover, that the only person authorized to perform this work, a priest, enjoys a special spiritual status that sets him apart from the rest of godly Christians. These German Protestant babies would object. That's why they'd like you to know that their baptism already makes them priest, bishop, and pope. Wait till they hit their terrible twos. So Protestants rejected the silent recitation of the canon because it contradicted their fundamental teachings on worship, justification, and the nature of the priesthood, and caused you to end up in the group on the right. Trent's counterattack. In response to these attacks, the Council of Trent in its 22nd session, held in 1562, explained the practice as follows. And since the nature of men is such that it cannot be easily lifted up to the meditation on divine things without external aids, for this reason has Holy Mother Church instituted certain rites, namely, that some things in the Mass be pronounced in a low voice and others in a louder voice. At the end of its exposition, the Council, exercising its infallible authority, then pronounced an anathema on those who condemned the silent recitation of the canon. If anyone says that the rite of the Roman Church, whereby part of the canon and the words of consecration are said in a low voice, should be condemned, let him be anathema. Vatican II's time bomb texts. The Council of Trent's pronouncement made the 20th century modernists in the liturgical movement squirm. Nothing could run more against their theories on corporate worship than a silent canon. And of course, they would have merely condemned, quote, the rite of the Roman Church whereby part of the canon and the words of consecration are said in a low voice, unquote. But the matter of an anathema stood in their way until Vatican II. The same time bomb passages in Vatican II's Constitution on the Sacred Liturgy that were employed against retaining the text of the Roman canon could also certainly be used against the rubric to recite it silently. How could a prayer possibly impart to the faithful rich instruction or make them conscious of what they are doing if they can't even hear it? So, the abolition of the silent canon, a tradition in the Roman Rite so ancient and venerable that no one can really tell us when, where, or how it began, fell victim to the modernist notion of worship as classroom and the primacy of the living assembly in May 1967, when priests were given permission to say the canon aloud. And with it disappeared the silence that betokens awe in the presence of such a tremendous mystery. for all, counterfeiting Christ's own words.
Reciting the canon aloud, though, was nothing compared to the other change that followed it in 1968, tampering with the words of consecration themselves.
Here, the Latin phrase that occurs in the consecration of the chalice, qui pro vobis et pro multis effundetur, which shall be shed for you and for many, was translated into most major Western languages as which shall be shed for you and for all men. But in Latin, for all is pro omnibus, not pro multis. It was an obvious mistranslation, so much so that even a high school sophomore in a minor seminary who had just 2 years of Latin could recognize the error. But then again, he would turn out to be a bit of a troublemaker. Omlor's landmark study.
In the United States, the appearance of this officially sanctioned outrage galvanized the nascent traditionalist movement. Since the mistranslation for all men occurred in the essential sacramental form, which actually brings about the consecration, the validity of the Mass itself was at stake.
The key figure in this controversy was the American Patrick Henry Omlor. Omlor had been the happy beneficiary of an excellent pre-Vatican II religious and classical education, and was the young father of a growing Catholic family. In March 1968, several months after the vernacular canon had appeared in English, Omlor published his book questioning the validity of the Masses using the new All-English canon. The foreword was written by Father Lawrence Bray, a priest of the Archdiocese of Milwaukee, who had been persecuted by his superiors for his refusal to use the phony translation. Omlor provided a concise recapitulation of what Catholic moral and dogmatic theology taught on the requisites for a valid sacramental form. He then argued that the new form in the All-English canon overthrew the requirement to use our Lord's own words for the consecration, that it destroyed the true sense of the form by substituting all for many, and that it suppressed something essential. He also pointed to the rubric St. Pius V promulgated in the front of the Missal, which said, quote, "If one were to omit or to change anything in the form of the consecration of the body and blood, and in that very change of the words, the new wording would fail to mean the same thing, he would not consecrate the sacrament."
Omlor concluded that due to the substantial change introduced into the meaning of the sacramental form, the consecration in Masses that used the All-English canon was invalid, that is, it did not take place.
Along the way, Omlor pointed out that the change contradicted both the Roman Catechism and St. Thomas, and that it was connected, moreover, to modern errors on ecumenism and on the nature of the Church. Questioning the validity went through several printings and became a traditionalist classic. It appeared most recently in a collection of his writings called The Robber Church. Omlor thus became a trailblazer for the traditionalist movement in America, long before anyone would hear of Archbishop Lefebvre or the Ottaviani intervention.
Many Catholics who were skeptical about the Vatican II changes came to reject them entirely once they read Omlor and became convinced that, thanks to this fraudulent translation, even the Blessed Sacrament itself had been taken away from them.
The Defenders. Omlor repeatedly battled over this issue with conservative defenders of the Vatican II changes, including Monsignor John F. McCarthy, Father William G. Most, and even the renowned lay Catholic intellectual Dietrich von Hildebrand. The controversy even reached Rome. Bugnini complained in his memoirs that he was repeatedly asked about it. So, Concilium commissioned a scholar from the Pontifical Biblical Institute, Father Max Zurwick, to defend the mistranslation. All the details need not concern us here. But the defense most commonly given for the mistranslation was that in Aramaic, the everyday language that our Lord spoke to his disciples, the word translated into Latin as promultus really has the sense of for all. On the face of it, it's a goofy argument, since we're talking about translating the Mass of the Roman Rite, not the Mass of the Aramaic Rite. But this should come as no surprise, because the origin for this theory turned out to be a 1949 work by Joachim Jeremias, a modernist Protestant scripture scholar, who among other things dismissed our Lord's miracles as products of the great imagination of ancient man.
Great source for understanding the words of consecration in the Roman canon, eh? The true meaning of the miracle of the Mass explained by someone who didn't believe in the truth of miracles.
Omlor triumphans. The fraudulent translation, for all, would be used for nearly 45 years. In the 1990s, however, the emergence of a neoconservative movement among younger clergy, buttressed by the ascendancy of Joseph Ratzinger, eventually led to a wholesale revision of the post-Vatican II vernacular translations of the Missal of Paul VI. None of those involved, of course, promoted the idea that the mistranslation of promultis compromised the validity of a Mass where it was used. But the tall tale told about Aramaic has finally been abandoned, and this modernist fraud, at least, implicitly acknowledged. So in the revised 2011 English translations of the Missal of Paul VI, the phrase promultis has finally been rendered correctly, as for many. And after 40 years, Patrick Henry Omlor, vindicated at last.
Summing up. First, the Reformers relabeled the canon as the Eucharistic prayer. Second, they increased the number of prefaces, making their usual appeal to restoring ancient tradition, while at the same time omitting texts deemed deficient because they did not conform to the modernist worldview. Third, following a program they had settled on in the late 1940s, the modernists sought to overhaul or abolish the venerable Roman canon, which they regarded as an agglomeration, illogical, disordered, deficient, and in the words of Bugnini, deplorable impoverishment and the product of centuries of liturgical decadence. Fourth, motivated by the modernist theology of assembly and mass as classroom, not to mention a general hatred for whatever savors of the mystical, the Reformers abolished the ancient practice of the silent canon in favor of bombarding the faithful with the celebrant's giant amplified voice. Fifth, based on a theory originated by a Protestant and modernist who rejected the truth of Christ's miracles, the modernists falsified Christ's own words and the formula of consecration itself. And this is only the first half of the story. To find out more about the destruction of the Roman canon, read Deplorable Impoverishment, Chapter 12 of Work of Human Hands, A Theological Critique of the Mass of Paul VI. Our next broadcast, the New Eucharistic Prayers.
To order Work of Human Hands, visit www.sggresources.org.